नमस्ते देवेंद्र, नमस्ते आरके सर, वनकम सर, वेरी नाइस टू बी
हेलो।
सीइंग यू एंड हियरिंग योर वॉइस एंड ऑल द टिप्स। हाय गणेश, हाय शर्मिला, डॉक्टर मजीद सर, आई होप दैट दिस टाइम विल बी यूजफुली स्पेंट बोथ वेज। आई फाउंड दिस ए good topic. Once Dr. Devendra gave me this topic, I started doing the surgeries. And if we look at the potential benefits of needling and the risk factors and factors we have to look for success and how we have to talk to the patient, the duration of the surgery is important, then vascularity is important, and height and number of needlings. Some of these factors are related inversely, and some are related directly to the success. And the more the number of needlings, the more difficult the problem is for us. So we are always looking for ways and means of validating our techniques and looking for new techniques to help our patients. So once upon a time, we used to say trabeclectomy means end of the road in terms of conventional surgery, and then the tubes. But the needlings have really come in very handy for us. We learned from each other, and so we can avoid the repeat traps and aquation procedures and dialysis to a later date if at all required. So we see the timing is important. The early failures are there and the late failures are there. And then depending on the location of the obstruction, the iris tissue or vitreous tissue, then ostium, whether it is open and whether the flap and edge are open or scarred, and the subconjunctival tissue and how the thickness is there, all these things are going to matter for overall success. Now, when we look at ab externo, we see that subconjunctival hemorrhage is a frequent occurrence, and probably this is one of the factors that leads us to difficult situations. And if we were to look at ab interno procedures, the subconjunctival hemorrhage is something that is less common. And that may help us. And of course, we would have fear of suprachoroidal hemorrhages or endophthalmitis to be more with the ab interno procedure. But if judiciously selected and well done, I think we may have a better or balanced situation either way. So at every point, we have to manage the risks and benefits and state the things and then take the decisions. So one of the important things is grading and then the ostium open or not, and what type of opening it is, whether it is pouting or just tightly scarred and still open. And then we go through the cycle, digital massage, suture removal, and then needling, by a few injections in between, and then ultimately, we have to take the decision regarding the ab interno needling. And the way I look at it, I have started looking at it, the less chance of bleeding may be the better thing about ab interno procedure. And instrumentation required, of course, is simple, but what I did was to bend a simple iris patella slightly anteriorly so that the angle that we get is more likely to be succeeding in reaching our goal. Now, whether the viscoelastic-aided procedure or bimanual procedure is working in our hands, we have to be aware of both. And once the procedure is over, we can see that I have fast forwarded it because I'm suspecting some time problem may come. See, the instrument is passing and going into the scleral area, subscleral area with ease or sometimes with difficulty. And then once we hydrate it, the flow comes out. So flow coming on the table may reduce subsequently and may need ultimately more further procedures. And how to go about these things? So the other technique under discussion, bimanual irrigation based technique. So this is the first incision, second incision with the help of a bent blade. And this is the bimanual technique, irrigation coming in from our FACO handpiece irrigation. And then when we hydrate at the end, we see flow and raised bleb. And what I am doing generally is that I am adding viscoelastic into a small area and then injecting 5-fluorouracil beyond it. This has been my technique and I think fairly successful. So postoperatively, this was the first day. The digital massage on the slit lamp reduced the pressure further. And I posted the case for two more 5-fluorouracil injections. And then finally, an IOP of 24 preoperatively in an end stage difficult case ended up with 16 millimeters in the long run. Now, what about the alternatives? Are any better alternatives available? Would our procedure benefit from these wonderful gonioscopic views? Is it really required? Let us just have a few considerations on that. Surgical gonioscopes are available. Swan Jacob, Katina, one that we use, that internationally is used for glucose stent. But the problem with these is that we have to bend our microscope. These microscopes are not generally available with most of our colleagues. And then the patient's head also has to be bent to other side. And then once we see the view, we find it coming to the other side. The ostium is somewhere here and the view that is coming is here. So this is surely a difficult technique. We will have to bend our backs and sometimes we may succeed. But if we were to lay our hands on this type of lens and innovative design that has been described in this article, double prism based gonio lens where are not required, then we might be more comfortable. But of course, whether this is necessary or not is the first thing. I think the surface anatomy based landmarks are sufficient for us to succeed and remove the fear complex or psychological barrier and be more effective with this procedure. I think that is the last slide. Thank you.